Thank you. Okay, so first of all, let me thank Chiara and Marcello for the nice invitation. And okay, so today I will talk about some results about the growth of Sobolev norms for linear time dependent Schrödinger equations. So let me start by describing the problem of growth of Sobolev norms. And so I will work mostly all of the time in an abstract setup, which I describe now. So I take H, a general Hilbert space, and over this Hilbert space, I consider an operator K0. So please try to remind K0 because it will play an important role in all the following talk. So K0, I will always assume it is a positive, self-adjoint, invertible operator with compact resolvent. So the role of K0 is that this is the operator which generates a scale of Hilbert spaces starting from my base space H in the following way. So I define HR as the domain of K0 to the power R. So this is defined by functional calculus. And this when R is strictly positive, and then I define H minus R by duality. And what I do now is I endow the scales of Hilbert spaces with what I call Sobolev norms. Actually, maybe a better name would be spectral norms, because these are defined as, so the R norm of a function psi is defined as the norm in the base space H of K0 to the R applied to most relevant applications that I will do of the abstract theory, then this norm turns out to be a classical Sobolev norm. So on this scale of Hilbert spaces, I am interested in studying the behavior of some linear time dependent Schrödinger equations of the following form. So IDT psi equal H psi plus V of T psi with an initial datum in HR. So this time dependent Schrödinger equation has two components. So first an operator H, which is the principal operator, which I consider as an amperator, so the amperator operator, and then I add a time dependent perturbation V of T. So later on I will give some assumption on this operator, but for the moment, something that I will always assume is the following. So H, as I mentioned, is the principal operator. It is self-adjoint and it commutes with K0. So recall that K0 is the operator that defined the Sobolev norms. And so the fact that H commutes with K0, this implies that the unperturbed flow preserves all the Sobolev norms. So for any initial datum, for any time, the norm of the evolution of the unperturbed equation, so the R norm of the evolution of the unperturbed equation is preserved for all time. So nothing happens. And then I add the perturbation V of T, which depends on time. It is a self-adjoint operator. And in some cases it might be unbounded, but it is always relatively bounded with respect to H. And I'm also interested in case where the dependence on time is very good. So let's say that the perturbation depends smoothly on time. Okay, so just for the sake of concreteness, so this is a very abstract setup and essentially almost all the examples that you can come up in the applications to PDEs will fit the setup. But for concreteness, let me give you three examples. So the first one is the Schrödinger equation on a general torus. So IDT phi equal minus Laplacian psi plus V of Tx. So here V is a smooth function of the time and of X. X belongs to, in this case, a rectangular torus, but you can generalize to flat tori. And so in this case, you can take as K0, the operator square root of one minus Laplacian, and the scale of Hilbert spaces that you generate is the classical Sobolev spaces on the d-dimensional. So these are the classical HR Sobolev spaces. And let me focus on another example. So you can have also the half wave equation on a zone manifold. And another example, which at some point will enter into play, are the harmonic oscillators on RD. So in this case, the equation is IDT phi equal, so you see here you have a linear combination of harmonic oscillator. Oscillator, so this is the sum when j goes from 1 to d of nu j square and minus derivative respect to j square plus x j square c, and then I add a perturbation. So in this case, you can take as k0 the classical, the standard harmonic oscillators, and the scale of Hilbert spaces that you generate, which are defined as the function which belongs to the domain of the power of the harmonic oscillator. So in this case, they coincide with function such that some derivatives, so all the derivatives up to order to R decay at a certain rate. All right. So the problem, so now I come back to the linear Schrödinger equation. So I'm interested in studying the dynamic of these linear equations. And the question more precisely is the following. So take an initial datum in HR and with R bigger than zero and consider the solution and take the HR norm. And then the question is, which is the behavior of this norm when the time tends to infinity? And more precisely, so is it possible that this norm goes to infinity in the sense that, for example, the lim sup when t goes to infinity of this norm is equal to infinity? Or how fast this norm can grow in time? Or on the opposite side, is it possible that this norm stays bounded for all times? And so this is the classical problem of growth of Sobolev norms, so to understand the large time behavior of the norm of the solution. And the reason why growth of Sobolev norm is has some interest is that this is a phenomenon which describes how the energy moves among frequencies. And so let me try to convince you about this. Take the operator k0. So I told you that in this case, k0 has a compact resolvent. So it has a basis of eigenfunctions. Let me denote this basis with en. And I know that k0 en is equal to lambda n en, and the sequence lambda n tends to infinity. And then if I decompose the solution on the basis of the operator k0, so I denote by psi n the n, so let me call it n Fourier coefficients. Then if I compute the HR norm of the solution, so this is just squared. So this is the sum over n of lambda n to the 2r and the modulus of the n Fourier coefficient squared. And so in particular, when r is equal to zero, this is the sum over n of the modulus of psi n t squared. But now recall that h plus vt is a self-adjoint operator. Because both H is self-adjoint and V is self-adjoint. And so for self-adjoint operator, we have the L2 conservation. So the propagator of the dynamic is unitary in the base space H. And so this means that this norm is constant for all time. So nothing changes. So you see the following. So you see that, so the H zero, so the zero norm is constant. And so if you see that this norm, instead of the HR norm with R positive, is growing in time, so the only possibility is that the energy has shifted from the low frequencies to the high frequencies. So let me make a picture. So what I'm saying is that here you have the frequencies. This is n, and then I have an initial mass like here. And then the mass is conserved, so the total amount of area below this. So this is the Fourier coefficient. So let me put here modulus of psi n square. So the total mass around here must be conserved. And then when I turn on the dynamic, so I take t bigger than zero, this shift in a different profile, but the change is so that the total mass is is conserved. So the total area below this curve is conserved. And so if this quantity grows in time, it means that the mass, or actually what I call it now, the energy, has shifted towards high frequencies. And so this is the phenomenon of weak turbulence, a low to high energy cascade. And somehow this is the phenomenon that I want to capture. Okay, so let me give you a classical example. A classical example is the Schrödinger equation on the torus. So I dt psi equal minus Laplacian plus vtx applied to psi. Here x is on the d-dimensional torus, and v is a function which is smooth in time and in x, and it is real valued. So for this example, we have results about upper bounds, which are due to Bourguin and Delors, and they say that, they say the following. So for any epsilon and r bigger than zero, there exists a constant bigger than zero such that the HR norm is bounded subpolynomial in time. So the HR norm is bounded by T to the epsilon times the initial datum for any epsilon. So this kind of results tells you, so it does not tell you that the Sobolev norm grows, but it tells you that if there is a transfer of energy, then this transfer of energy is subpolynomial in time. And then there has been extension of this result. So Weiming Wang and then later Fang Zhang extended this result in the following way. So you see that, so Bourguin and Delors consider a potential which is smooth, and instead Wang and Fang consider a potential which is analytic in time and space. And then in this case, you can replace the T to the epsilon growth by a log T to some power sigma growth. And this is optimal. And then recently with Massimiliano Berti, we extended this result from the square torus to general flat tori, so in particular irrational tori. And if you heard yesterday the talk by Riccardo Montalto, you know that recently Bambusi, Langella and Montalto extended this result when V is an unbounded operator, so not necessarily a multiplication operator. Okay, so for these results, you have also a result of growth due to Bourguin, and the result is the following. So there exists, so it constructs a potential which is analytic in time and space, and there exists, and it constructs initial datum psi zero such that the lim sup when t goes to infinity of the HR norm of the solution is plus infinity. So he's able to engineer a perturbation and the initial datum such that this transfer of energy actually happens. And for this result, there are also, we know also result of localization, and these are due to Eliasson and Poussin. And so for these results, you need that the perturbation is small in size. And second, you need the perturbation not to depend freely on time. As you see here, for this kind of results, at least for the upper bounds, V can depend freely on time. For the localization, you require that V depends in a quasi-periodic way in time with a frequency omega, which is very special. It is very irrational, very diophantine. And in practice, you prove that there exists a Cantor set such that if this frequency belongs to the Cantor set, then you have localization. So no growth of Sobolev norms at all. So the sup in T of the solution is always controlled. Okay, so in the recent year, this kind of upper bounds result and localization result has been extended to many more models, and the growth is still, I would say, not very well understood. And this is what I want to talk about today. But before, let me mention that all these questions, so upper bounds, lower bounds, and localization are also very interesting and very important, also in the nonlinear case. And so, for example, for the upper bounds, there are upper bounds for the Schrödinger equation, for the generalized KdV equation, and it tells that the HR norm of the solution grows polynomial in time, so typically the HR norm grows as t to some constant mu times r, and these are results due to Burgen and then Giuliola Staffilani and many other. About lower bounds, there are essentially two known results. So the first result is a long time strong instability for the nonlinear Schrodinger equation on the torus. So this is kind of result which tells you that you can construct a solution such that its initial norm is arbitrarily small, and after some time it becomes arbitrarily large. So there is a growth over a finite time interval. And this kind of result was proved in a breakthrough by the I-team and then recently also Zairani, Guardia-Kaloshin, House Procesi have extended this result. And then the second kind of lower bounds which are known are, some results of unbounded growth. So actually there are two results of unbounded growth for very special model. So the Zego equation, and which is due to Gerard de Grelier, and the nonlinear Schrodinger equation on a cylinder, which is due to Annie Poisson-Derzvetko and Vichy. And these are the only two very special cases where there is, for a nonlinear equation, there are trajectories which are unbounded, which becomes unbounded for time. Okay, and in general, let me just mention that there are also some results about localization, but these are typically connected to integrability. So they hold true with KDV and the focusing and Benjamin Ono. Okay, so what I want to talk about today are lower bounds for linear Schrodinger equations. So the situation is this, I have IDT psi equal H psi plus VTXD psi, and the question is, can we construct solutions undergoing Sobolev norm explosion? And somehow you see the question is, can we engineer a perturbation which is able to transport energy from low to high frequencies? So let me give you two definitions which will help me to describe the known result. So definitions are the following. So I say that a perturbation V is a transporter if there exists a solution of this equation such that the lim sup when t goes to infinity of the HR norm is equal to plus infinity. So a transporter is a perturbation which is able to produce a shift of frequency from low to high, at least for one solution. And the second definition, I say that the perturbation is a universal transporter if for any non-trivial solution, the lim sup when t goes to infinity of the HR norm is equal to plus infinity. So universal transporter is a much stronger object. So it is able to push energy no matter the initial datum. Okay, so the state of the art is the following. So for the moment, we have a zoo of transporters. And so in particular, we have eight explicit examples of equations, of linear time-dependent equations for which we know the existence of unbounded trajectories. And the pioneering work was done again by Burgen, and then a recent result, some years ago by Delors, and then something that I proved myself a couple of years ago. And then more recently, there is a work of Erwan Fahou and Pierre Raphael and also Laurent Thomas. And okay, what I want you to focus is the following. So essentially two information. So the first information is that you see essentially these results of growth are known in one dimension, except for this case where we have a Dirac equation on a Zoll manifold, and this case where there is a harmonic oscillator on R2. So here, SCH is Schrodinger, and HO is harmonic oscillator. And then the second information is that universal transporters exist. And in general, and the third information is that in general, the perturbation that you need to construct is not a simple multiplication operator, but it is a pseudo-differential operator. And in these cases, for this equation, you also have explicit rate of growth. Okay, so okay, this is the known situation. So we have 8 explicit examples, and for all these examples, the perturbation is constructed ad hoc for the problem. So at the moment, I would say there is no general procedure to construct a perturbation which provokes growth of Sobolev norm. And you need to have enough fantasy to construct an example. And so what I want to tell you today is instead, so what I want to do is to try to give you sufficient, explicit, and robust conditions which ensure that a perturbation is a transporter. So sufficient, you all know what it means. Explicit, it means that if you give me a perturbation, I have a simple criteria which enables me to determine if this perturbation is a transporter or not. And robust, it means stable under perturbation. So if I have a transporter and if I add a perturbation to this transporter, do I still get a transporter? So is this instability phenomenon somehow stable under perturbations? So these are the questions that I want to discuss. Okay, so let me tell you what I can do. So the setup, so I will state the result in an abstract setup and then I will show you an application. So the result is the following. I consider as usual I consider this equation, IT psi equal k0 psi plus VTX psi. And the assumptions that I do are the following. So the first one is I assume that all the operators are self-differential operators. And in particular, the principal operator is a pseudo-differential operator of order one, and the perturbation V is a pseudo-differential operator of order zero of your favorite class of pseudo-differential operator. So the specific class depends on the problem you have at hand, but in general, you need K0 to be of order one and be a bounded operator. So the second set of assumptions concern the spectrum of K0. So I ask that K0 has constant spectral gaps and the spectrum of K0 is a subset of the integers up a translation. So here mu is a positive parameter and is a translation. So the situation that I have in mind is of course when K0 is the harmonic oscillators where the spectrum is integers plus 1/2. And third, the last assumption, which is the most important, which concerns the perturbation. And the assumption is the following. So I ask that V is time 2π periodic, self-adjoint. And then I define its resonant average, which I denote by this square bracket. And this is one over 2π integral between 0 and 2π of, so I take the perturbation and then I conjugate back and forth with the flow of the unperturbed operator K0. And then I integrate in time between 0 and 2π and I divide by 1/2π. So I call this the resonant average. So the last two set of assumptions concern the resonant average of V. And these two assumptions are that the resonant average has a non-trivial absolutely continuous spectrum. So there exists an open interval such that in this interval, the resonant average has absolutely continuous spectrum. And then the most important one is a Moore estimate over the interval I. So a Moore estimate means the following. I ask that there exists a pseudo-differential operator of order one, self-adjoint, such that I have the following. So if I take the commutator between the resonant average V and this operator A, and then I localize in energy, then this object is bounded from below by a positive constant up to a compact operator. So here K is a compact operator, theta is a positive constant, and here I'm denoting EI, the spectral projectors of the operator V. So the classical Moore estimates, which comes from Moore in some works of quantum mechanics. Okay, so under these assumptions, the result that I can prove is the following. So the first theorem is that, so assume 1, 2, 3, then V is a transporter, and more precisely, for any R bigger than zero, there exists a solution in HR such that the HR Sobolev norm grows as T to the power R. So it grows polynomial in time. And the second result is a result of stability of transporters, which tells you that if now you take one of these transporters and you perturb it, then you still get a transporter. So more precisely, for any small enough perturbation, W, which is simply a pseudo-differential operator of order zero, sufficiently small, and you consider V plus W, then you get a transporter. And so the key idea is the following. So what will happen is that the dynamic of this equation is well approximated in a way that I will explain to you by an effective equation, which is IDT C equal resonant average of V plus some lower order terms. And then the Moore estimate that I proved for V imply that there is a dispersion, but in the frequency space. The Moore estimate implies that, so I prove dispersive estimate in the frequency space for this equation. And so dispersive estimate tells you that in this case, the energy is shifting to infinity. And that is exactly the mechanism of growth of Sobolev. So for this case, the growth is obtained because I'm able to conjugate this equation to an equation with absolutely continuous spectrum for which I can prove dispersive estimates in the frequency space. Okay, so let me make a couple of remarks. So the first remark is the following. So both in both theorem one and theorem two, so K0 and V are self-adjoint. So this means that the H0 norm of the solution is constant for all the time. So this is exactly a forward energy cascade. And the second remark is that, so essentially theorems two tells you that, so this one tells you a sort of stability of instability. So the set of transporter has open components. And so I start to believe that the instability phenomenon might not be so uncommon. And then the last remark that I want to do is that this is a resonant phenomenon. And the reason is that the perturbation is 2π periodic in time. So the frequency of oscillation of the perturbation, it resonates with the spectral gaps of K0. And this is even more evident because of the following. So take one of these transporter that I constructed, take the same operator, but just change the frequencies at which it is oscillating in time. So here it is 2π periodic. And now take it which oscillates at a frequency omega, with a frequency omega extremely diophantine. And then typically one is able to prove a reducibility result. So if now the perturbation it is very irrational, then one can prove that every norm of any solution is uniformly bounded in time. So absolute, there is no growth. So it is just sufficient to tune your frequencies. So if you pass from a resonant frequency to a non-resonant frequency, you are able to either construct solutions with unbounded trajectories, or you get an equation for which all the solutions have bounded Sobolev norms for all times. Okay, so let me give you an application of this result. So let me give you a simple application. And okay, the screen is blocked. No, Okay, it's moving. So let me give you a simple application, and the application is the half wave equation on the toroid. So I consider I dt psi equals modulus of d plus vtx psi, x is on the toroid. And then the theorem is the following. So take v of x, any function smooth, real valued, and such that its j Fourier coefficient is different from zero for a j not zero. And then what I claim is that vtx defined as cosinus of jt times vx is a transporter. And so in particular, there exist solutions with growing subreports. Okay, so what is the proof of this result? So the proof is I need just to verify the three assumptions of my theorem. So the first one is that D is epsilon differential operator of order one. Okay, this is clear. B is epsilon differential operator of order zero. This is also clear because this is a multiplication operator. And then the second assumption is that the spectrum of D must have a constant spectral gap. And this is true because the spectrum of the modulus of D is just the integer n. Okay, and then what I need to do is to compute the resonant average of this perturbation. So the resonant average, I have Vtx equal cosinus of Jt times V of x, and to consider the resonant average, which is 1 over 2 pi, the integral between 0 and 2 pi of the original operator when I conjugate back and forth by the unperturbed equation. Okay, so you can compute explicitly this using a Gorov theorem, which is in this formula, which tells you how a pseudo-differential operator transforms when you conjugate back and forth with the flow of modulus of D. And so let me give you just the final result. So when you do this computation, you can do it explicitly, and you find that this is equal to the real part of V at J times the J Fourier coefficients times e to the ijx plus a pseudo differential operator of order minus one. And so you see that this is a multiplication operator by a real function. Let me call it again V of x. And so you see that the spectrum of the resonant average, so this is a compact perturbation of a multiplication operator. So for sure, this contains the range of this function, which is minus V at J and modulus of V at J. So for sure, there is some absolutely continuous spectrum. And then I need to verify a Moore estimate for this multiplication operator. Okay, and then I do the following. I define the operator A to be Wx dx over I plus dx over I Wx, where Wx is the imaginary part of V at J into the ijx. And then you compute the commutator between your resonant average and A, and also this is an explicit computation, and you get that this is 2J times the modulus of V at J square minus the resonant average of V square plus something compact. And so you see that this is an operator which depends just on the resonant average of V. So I define this to be F of resonant average of V, where the function F of lambda is just 2J times modulus V at J square minus lambda square. Okay, and now I want to prove a Moore estimate for this commutator, meaning that I need to localize in frequency by taking the spectral projector. So let me just take the spectral projector over a certain interval I of V. So I need to compute this, IV times a function phi scalar product with phi. And then you can use, this is F. So this is actually a function of F of V up to some compact operators. And so you can use the spectral theorem to compute this scalar product. And the spectral theorem tells you that this is equal to the integral of the characteristic function on the interval I of lambda times f of lambda, and then the spectral measure of the resonant average of V, so your operator associated with the vector phi in lambda, plus always some compact operators. Okay, so now I want to bound from below this, but you can do this easily because you see, so this is, here I want to plot, here I have the spectrum of the resonant average. So I know that the spectrum is contained in minus, actually it contains minus modulus of V at J and V at J. And then the function f lambda, this is a parabola, an inverted parabola with zeros at the point plus or minus modulus of V at J. So the function f of lambda is like this. Okay, so what I need to do is just to select an interval I such that this quantity is bounded from below. But you see that this is very easy to do because it is sufficient that I take an interval I inside here, and then for sure inside this interval I have that the function f of lambda is bounded from below by some value which I call theta, and so from this I get the lower bound. This is bigger than theta times the integral of chi lambda spectral measure phi lambda plus some compact, and again by the spectral theorem this is equal to theta times the norm of the spectral projector over the interval, and so this is the Moore estimate for the operator always plus some compact. So in this way we have verified that we have verified the assumption, and in practice this proves that this operator is a transporter. Okay, so okay, and then another application that you can do is for the harmonic oscillator on R, and also in this case you can apply the theorem and one can construct a class of transporters which is stable under perturbations and for which you have solutions growing polynomially fast in time. Okay, so let me skip this part for the moment and let me give you an idea of the proof of the result. Okay, so first of all, so you see that Moore estimates will play an important role. So let me give you a crash course in Moore theory and especially local energy decay estimates. So the setup is, so I assume that people coming from quantum mechanics know this very well. So I will be very, very sketchy in this part, so apologize. So the situation is the following. So I have two operators, H and A, which are self-adjoint and such that the intersection of their domain is dense. And then I take I, an open bounded interval, such that the commutator, so I take the commutator between A and H and iterate the commutators. And then if I localize these commutators on a spectral interval, I refer to the operator H, then I get bounded operators. And then the Moore estimate, which is the same that I told before. So I assume that over this interval, if I take the commutator between H and A and I localized in the energy, then this commutator is bounded from below by theta times GIA squared plus a compact operator. So here, with respect to before, I'm taking a function GI, which instead is smooth, is a infinity, and such that it is equal to 1 over I, and then 0 afterwards. So which is for technical point of view is slightly more convenient than using the exact spectral projector. Okay, so this is a Moore estimate. So the commutator localizing energy is bounded from below up to a compact operator, and there is also a strict Moore estimate, which So strict Moore estimate if this estimate holds true with k equal to zero. Okay, so the Moore theorem tells you the following. So in case you have a Moore estimate, then the spectrum of H over the interval I is absolutely continuous, except for finitely many eigenvalues with finite multiplicity. And moreover, if you have a strict Moore estimate, then in the interval I, you cannot have eigenvalues. So if you have spectrum, the spectrum must be absolutely continuous. And then a second result, which is the most relevant for us, are the local energy decay estimate. So you see here the operator H has absolutely continuous spectrum in this interval, so you can expect dispersive estimate, and these dispersive estimates exist. And the result is the following. So if you have a strict Moore estimate, so with k is equal to zero, then if you shrink a little bit the interval I, so you take a J strictly contained in I, then for any k in n, we have a local energy decay estimate of the following form. So you take a function phi, you localize it in the energy in the interval J, you apply the evolution of the flow of generated by the operator H, and then you weight this by the Japanese bracket of A to the powers minus K. So here, so in this slide, this denotes the Japanese bracket, 1 plus modulus of C square to the 1 over 2, and this is defined by functional calculus in this slide. And so the local energy decay estimate tells you that this quantity in the norm H decays in time as 1 over T to the power K, provided your initial datum is sufficiently regular, in the sense that if you test it when with a to the power k, then this quantity is finite. So this local energy decay estimate are due to Zigal software, and then Unziger-Sigar software, and many more. And they typically come up when you study the Schrödinger. So you might have seen this kind of inequality for the Schrödinger equation on Euclidean spaces. And then in this case, so on Rn, the typical estimate that you get is when A is the, so you get an estimate of the form, so when A is the operator X, is the position of operator. And then, so A equal to X. And then actually x dx over I plus x over I x. And then in this case, you have a shift of the mass to plus infinity. Okay, so let me show you how one can use this local energy decay estimate to prove growth of sublevels. So let me do this on a toy model, which is very simple, but this is the example to understand. And so the toy model is the following. So let me consider I dtu equal cosinus of x times u. And x is on the one-dimensional toy. So I claim that this toy model has growing Sobolev norms. And I will give you two proofs of this result. So the first proof is an analysis one proof, and you just write explicitly the solution. So the solution of this equation is utx equal e to the minus it cosinus of x times the initial datum. And then this has growing Sobolev norms, because when you take the derivative respect to x of the solution, so you have two contribution. So once the derivative falls on the initial datum, and then nothing happens. But once the derivative falls on the oscillating factor, and in this case, you have minus it, actually plus it, sinus of x, and e to the minus it cos x u zero x. And so you see that in this case, you have a power t coming down, and the more derivative you take, more power of t comes down. And so when you take the L2 norm of this, you see that this grows as t. Okay, so this equation has growing Sobolev. Now we will give you a second proof of this result, using local energy decays. So the proof is more sophisticated, but in this case, the proof exhibit, so it put into light the fact that, so I want to give you a proof which use dispersive estimate in the frequency space. And so here I want to exploit that the multiplication operator by cosinus of X has absolutely continuous spectrum in the interval minus one. Okay, and I do this using local energy decay estimate as before. So I need to find an operator A, which has a positive commutator with the cosinus of X. And so I just define the operator A like this one, which is very similar to the one of the example before. So A is just the sinus of X derivative respect to X over I plus dx over I sinus of X. And then if you compute explicitly this commutator, then so here H is the cosinus of X, you compute explicitly this commutator and you get two times sinus square of X. And so you can rewrite this as two times one minus H square. So this is essentially the same computation that I did you before. And so when you localize in energy, you can get a strict Moore estimate. So if you have a strict Moore estimate for this, you apply local energy decay estimate. And then you have that if you take initial datum C, you localize it in a spectral interval J, you consider the flow, and then you weight this with A to the minus K, then this quantity decays as 1 over TK times this norm of the initial datum. And now you look at the following. So HA, so this is a pseudo differential operator of order 1. So A minus K, this one is essentially a pseudo differential operator of order minus K, meaning that what I'm considering here is actually the minus K norm, so the negative Sobolev norm of the initial datum. So what I'm telling is that a negative Sobolev, so I constructed the initial datum such that the negative Sobolev norm is decaying in time as 1 over T to the K times the norm of the initial datum. But now you have conservation of L2. So you know that the solution, the L2 norm of the solution is constant for all time. And now Cauchy-Schwarz, so this is phi t hk times phi t h minus k. And so you see that if this quantity is tending to zero, as 1 over tk, the only possibility is that the positive Sobolev norm grow in time at the same speed. So you get the lower bound from this. So from if the the negative Sobolev norm decays in time, then the argument give you a growth of the positive Sobolev norm. Okay, so the second proof is much more complicated by with respect to the first one, but it has two terrific advantages. So the first advantage is that in the second proof, I do not need to know explicitly the flow. So here I needed to integrate the equation, here no. The only information that I need is a lower bound on a commutator. And the second terrific advantage is that this kind of dispersive estimates are stable under perturbations because these commutators also these lower bounds are stable under perturbation. And so at some point the strategy that I will follow to prove the theorem is that I start with the system and then doing some normal form I reduce the original system to a perturbation of a toy model of this form. And since the dispersive estimates are stable under perturbation, I'm able to prove that also the perturbed system that I obtain has decaying Sobolev norm, has decaying negative Sobolev norm, and so growth of positive Sobolev norms. And okay, so so my time is essentially over. So let me just give you just a sketch of the proof. So the tools that I need to prove the theorem is I need to combine pseudo differential normal form and dispersive estimates. So the first step, I do a pseudo differential normal form. So for any n, I conjugate the original equation IDTC, like a zero plus VTC, to an effective equation, which is IDTC equal resonant average of V plus a lower order time independent perturbation plus a regularizing reminder. So these regularize how much as you want. And in the second step, I consider the effective equation, which is this one, IDTC equal resonant average of V plus Tn, and I prove a local energy decay estimate for this operator. So using Moore theory, I'm able to prove that the negative Sobolev norm of this effective equation decay in time. And so I have growth of positive Sobolev norm. So you see that for the effective equation, growth happen as a dispersion phenomenon in the frequency space. And the last step, I use an approximation argument to say that, so I construct a solution of the complete equation, this one, which stays close for all time to a solution of the effective equation. And this is possible because essentially this remainder is a regularizing operator, is an arbitrary regularizing operator. So let me just, to conclude, let me just mention, so maybe we skip the part of construction of the rest of normal form. Let me just tell you one step about the local energy decay estimate, which is the following. So I consider this perturb operator and I want to prove a local energy decay estimate. So as I told you, assumption three guarantees that this decay estimate is true if in this case, the operator Tn is equal to zero. Thanks to local energy decay estimate. And so what we need to do is to prove that these perceived estimates are stable if I add here a perturbation Tn. But Tn is a compact operator. And in principle, there is a danger. And the danger is that, so you see, for this estimate to be true, you need that the resonant average of V plus Tn has absolutely continuous spectrum. But if Tn is a compact operator, so this might destroy completely the absolutely continuous spectrum. So absolutely continuous spectrum is not stable under compact perturbation. So you have against the Weibull-Neumann theorem, which tells you that V plus Tn might have pure point spectrum. And so there is no dispersion at all. And the way to get around this is again to exploit estimate. And so you prove that you prove that V plus Tn fulfills a Moore estimate. So if you know, okay, if you know this, then you know that in the interval where V has absolutely continuous spectrum, then this operator cannot have just a pure point spectrum because this is against the Moore estimate. Okay, so I think that my time is over. So let me skip this part. And let me thank you for your attention.
Okay, shall we maybe start with questions from the online audience? Is there anyone in the online? Okay, do we have any questions here?
Alberto, sorry, just a naive question. So, but about the assumptions of your main result, are these fulfilled by the previous works that have been done on Rotov-Sobolev norms? Let's say, I mean, you gave a nice historical overview, and I just wanted to know if.
No, so these assumptions are. So, my understanding is these assumptions are new. Mm-hmm. And in general, they are not verified. It's not clear to me that they are verified by the previous examples.
Can I ask
maybe one to check if the result of Delore is this assumption, but his construction is actually very different. It's very different.
Okay, and then I have a second question about you had an assumption on the constant spectral gaps, right?
Yes, sir.
Is this essential or can you relax it and somehow, I mean, just assume some bounds on the spacing?
So what you at the moment you cannot relax it very much. So you can relax this. So You can ask at K0 not to have constant spectral gaps, but to have asymptotically constant spectral gaps.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So on perturbation of this, you can relax. But if you ask K0 to have increasing spectral gaps, so for example, minus dxx on the tori, then you have increasing spectral gaps, and I assume I suspect that the mechanism of growth in that case is completely different. So in this case, with quantum spectral gap, the mechanism is that you have a resonance which conjugates your equation, so which creates an operator with absolutely continuous spectrum. But in case of increasing spectral gaps, I suspect that this is not what happened. Mm-hmm. The mechanism of growth is completely different.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, any more questions here or anyone online? Maybe I was wondering, you say in general the transporters are pseudo differential operators, right? There are some examples where they are multiplication operators, but in the case where they are pseudo differential operators, can you show that actually they cannot be multiplication operators? In some cases, at least, examples?
I don't know. So you want to know if I think in pre so no the okay so so my feeling is that in principle you can construct also transporters which are general multiplication of operators, so in principle one should be able to do this. In general, the construction is simpler in the pseudo-differential class because of the normal form. So from the technical point of view, you want to do some change of coordinates which involves pseudo-differential operators. So the normal form that you perform stays closed in the pseudo-differential class. I don't know if I answer your question.
Yes, thanks. Any other questions? No online questions? Yeah, no? Okay, well then let's thank Alberto again.
Thank you.